Greetings. Jesus taught the parable of the four soils. This is the parable of the four men. The first man listened to the voice of evil and made the evil his own voice. He chose to do wrong, and he knew it was wrong. When he spoke, he often lied. He lied to the point he believed his own lies. He would lie for any reason or no reason at all. The next man was unlearned. He had a sincere heart, but no knowledge to guide it. When he met the first man, he had no way to even tell which were lies or half-truths. But little by little, the unlearned man was taken in by the lies of the first. When he would occasionally have a spark of insight, he would catch the first man in a lie but not realize it. He would ask the first man a question, and quickly thinking on his feet, the first man would weave another lie. Often the first man would include truths and stories that were commonly known. It gave his lies the ring of truth. But in reality, the ring of truth hid the central lie being told. The second man was sincere, but his lack of knowledge was what doomed him to being deceived. The third man was raised to never confront anyone. It was the peaceful thing to do. He was told that all men were hypocrites. The one accusing was always guilty of the same accusation. So whenever he heard a challenge or accusation, he would say, "Yeah, but they all do that." He never examined a behavior or an action or a person with any critical judgment. The third man became a moral relativist because he could never bring himself to judge. He chose to be willfully ignorant, refusing to give any thought to the possibility that there is truth. Instead, when told that truth existed, the willfully ignorant man would just retort, "What is truth?" More a deflecting statement than a question. More empty rhetoric than honest appeal. And because he rejected the existence of truth, he was unable to recognize any solution to his problems. He lived a life of victimhood because he could never think critically about a problem and discern a true answer. In fact, all answers were the same to him, and therefore any answer he felt good about became his answer. He never took time to look back at his decisions. He thought that was a wasted effort. No one could have chosen a better answer because all answers must be the same, he thought. So there was no reason to review his answer or his decision process. By doing so, he thus convinced himself to remain willfully ignorant. Never able to learn from his mistakes or recognize his weaknesses. When the third man met the first, Will was gregarious and accepting. Will listened and accepted what the first man said. His stories seemed believable. With no basis for intelligent comparison, Will accepted the stories of the first man. And as Will recognized things that were not true in his tales, Will would ask him, "Why the false statements?" You see, Will had the capacity to discern truth and error, contradiction and inconsistency. But Will could never detect the willful deception of the first man. The first man would say, "Oh, that was a mistake. Oh, I forgot. Oh, I think you just misunderstood. Oh, that information has been changed, abrogated. How dare you question me? Don't you trust me?" And given the strength of the assertion, Will would shrink from the exchange. His willful ignorance robbed him of the power to stand by the truth against the lies. The last man was raised from a boy to know the truth. He had learned that truth is the best friend of logic, and he had befriended logic as well. Together with truth, logic was a light in the darkness. When faced with statements that sounded good, the last man would think about it logically. He would ponder, "Is this true for all men, for all mankind?" Truly, injustice hides behind ideas and policies and laws that only apply to some. When Ernest met the first man, it did not take long to discern the lies. The first man said that he was told by God to start a religion. Ernest said, "Amen! It is good to follow God who made heaven and earth. Tell me about your religion, my friend." And the first man told him of the teachings of his religion. "You are a man, I am a man, and all men are better than all women," he said. "Yes, we are stronger," Ernest said, "but women carry life. We are different. How can we be better?" "My religion says because they carry life, one man can have more than one woman. In fact, my religion is better than all other religions because you can have four." "But then, why do you have more than four, brother?" "I am special, brother. The laws God gave to men do not apply to me." And with that, a voice of truth in Ernest's heart spoke to him. "Beware the man that gives laws he will not have to follow." "Tell me more about your new religion, brother." "Gladly, but it is not a new religion at all. You see, I call those who follow my religion God's followers. And all who have ever followed the great God were God's followers. So they have all followed my religion, even though they did not know its name." "And you say that your religion is the same religion as they believed?" "Oh yes, their religion is exactly the same as what I am now teaching." "But I have studied their religion. In fact, I follow it." "Oh, very good. And since you are God's follower, you must now follow me too." And as they talked, the voice of truth kept speaking to Ernest. "Ask this man the name of the one God you follow." So Ernest asked, and the first man did not know the name of God. "Why do you have to fold your arms a certain way and bend a certain way to pray?" Ernest asked. "Oh, it is the way all of God's followers have always prayed," the first man said. And the voice of truth rose up in Ernest. "That is not true. Those who follow the one God pray many ways, none the right and only way. The men of old would pray prostrate on the ground. They would look up to the sky. Why do we have to pray facing the mountain?" "Oh, it is not the mountain we face. We pray to my hometown on the other side of the mountain. My hometown is so important to me that it must be holy in the religion I teach." Again, the voice of truth rose up in Ernest. "The holy city of God is another city. It is the city on the holy hill where God lives." And Ernest began to know what the man was saying was false. But was this man truly of the first kind, the second, or even the third kind? Ernest sought for an answer and meditated long and hard for the truth. And the answer finally came to him. "It does not matter if the other man is of the first kind, or the second, or even the third. It only matters that Ernest is the fourth kind of man. It only matters that Ernest knows the truth and loves the truth. The first kind of man has decided to replace the truth with lies. The second kind does not care enough about the truth to work hard to obtain it. The third kind knows there is a burden to possessing the truth and would rather an easy path to a lie than the hard path to the truth." But again, the voice of truth rose up in Ernest. "Because you know the truth, Ernest, and because you love the truth, you must look for the third kind of man and encourage him. He needs to be strengthened to choose the truth that he can discern. You must look for the second kind of man and teach him. He needs your patience and love like a small child. He would gladly choose the truth if it were taught to him. But right now he is only hearing the lies of the first man. And hearing no different, the second man has no option, no opportunity. But what of the first man? Ernest pondered. Even he deserves to hear and see and feel and experience the truth, because the truth shines like a light in darkness. The truth gives the glow of warmth of the sun on a warm day. The truth of the one true God can even melt the heart frozen with lies. So which of these four men are you? I pray that you are earnest and that you love the truth. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.